I'm pleased to be here again. My name is Christopher Ricks. Measure for Measure isn't a play that everybody has reread recently. How about that? So I want to say something about this great Shakespearean play for those of you who don't know it well. And I'm going to read the summary of the plot from a rather old-fashioned work of reference, because the old-fashionedness of describing the plot is, to me, interesting. The summariser in the Oxford handbook can't bring himself to use the words that the play uses. So Measure for Measure. The Duke of Vienna, on the pretext of a journey to Poland, hands over the government to Angelo that he may escape the odium of enforcing laws against unchastity that have long since been disregarded. Angelo at once sentences to death Claudio as guilty of seduction. Claudio sends word of his position to his sister Isabella, a novice, and begs her to intercede with Angelo. Isabella's prayers fail to win her brother's pardon, but her beauty awakens Angelo's passion, and at a second interview he offers her her brother's life if she will sacrifice to him her honour. Isabella indignantly refuses, and there follows the famous scene in the prison when Isabella tells her brother of Angelo's offer, and he, momentarily weakening, pleads with her for his life. Meanwhile, the Duke, who has not left Vienna but assumed the disguise of a friar and thus learned the infamous conduct of Angelo, contrives the saving of Claudio as follows. He bids Isabella consent to go to Angelo's house at midnight and obtains that Mariana, who had been betrothed to Angelo and loved him but had been cast off by him, shall go there in Isabella's place. The ruse is successful, but nonetheless Angelo orders Claudio's execution at dawn. The provost of the prison disobeys. The Duke, laying aside his friar's robes and simulating an unexpected return to Vienna, hears the complaint of Isabella and the suit of Mariana and confutes Angelo, who denies their stories. Angelo is pardoned at the instance of Mariana and Isabella, and married to the former, and the Duke reveals his love for Isabella. Now, it's a perfectly faithful summary, but you'll pick up the old-fashioned language. Nobody is sentenced to death as guilty of seduction. That isn't something you're sentenced to death for. laws against unchastity and so on. Fornication is what the law is against. It's a word that's rather gone out, as perhaps the practice has not gone out or come in. Nobody ever says, you know, fornication, hello, and so on. So that's something ants do, isn't that right? Despite the language, or because of the gap between this rather Victorian language and the play, we have a reminder of how things change and simultaneously don't change. Now, what I want to do is read the opening of the play to remind some and to inform others. And it opens with, I think, one of the most extraordinary openings anywhere in Shakespeare. Enter Duke, Aeschylus, and other lords. Duke speaks first. Aeschylus, my lord. It's a wonderful way to open play. It looks the easiest pie to do that. What it is, it's like the tap of a conductor's baton. It's simply an exchange that intimates power. Aeschylus, my lord. So it's immediately set up what the power situation is, and there's a brevity in it at the point about it. It's a tiny opening ceremony. And it's succeeded immediately by something which is very different because of the elaboration of the wording. The line, I'll quote the whole speech, but of government the property to unfold. Now that's a very extraordinary way. Aeschylus, my lord. Of government the properties to unfold would seem in me to affect speech and discourse, since I am put to know that your own science exceeds in that the list of all advice my strength can give you. Then no more remains but this, to your sufficiency as your worth is able, and let it work. The nature of our people, our cities, institutions, and the terms for common justice, you are as pregnant in as art and practice have enriched any that we remember. There is our commission. Handing a scroll. There is our commission from which we would not have you walk. Call hither, I say, bid come before us, Angelo. And turns to Aeschylus, what figure of us think you he will bear? For you must know we have a special soul, elected him our absence to supply, lent him our terror, dressed him with our love, and given his deputation all the organs of our own power. What think you of it? If any in Vienna be of worth to undergo such ample grace and honour, it is Lord Angelo. There's a terrific dynamic in this opening scene. Aeschylus must expect that he is being given the power. Aeschylus, my lord, the commission is handed to him. And then the Duke goes on to say, call hither Angelo, what figure of us think you he will bear? And Aeschylus should, I think for a moment, rather than glibly reply, if any in Vienna be of worth to undergo such ample grace and honour, it is Lord Angelo. If I'd been in that position, I would have said, if any in Vienna be of worth to undergo such ample grace and honour, is that pointing to my lips? Aeschylus rises above competitiveness in this, and one of the things you find out in the play is that of the two people to whom power is disputed, the one to whom less power is deputed is the one who conducts himself in such power honourably and fairly and with compassion as well as dispassion. The difficult thing, clearly, in any play involving the law is that sexual intercourse outside marriage is now a capital offence. If you say what could possibly make fornication a capital offence, one answer is venereal disease, and the play is full of references to sexually transmitted disease or venereal disease. It has brothels in it, it has a brothel keeper, it has whores in it. The huge gap you see between the decorous Victorian language of the summary and what's actually happening in the play. That makes sense, as in a way closing bathhouses when AIDS was first raging through California made sense. There's a point in which aren't people free to do what they like? The danger to public health can be a matter of major national security. So that's something like the background, and it explains why there are all these jokes. Some of them are very funny. All of them what William Empson, the wonderful poet and critic, called trench humour. The kind of jokes you made in the Great War about gangrene, or about rot, or about bombs, or about rats. I mean, it's a humour which tries to deal with terrifying things by finding some kind of witty communal feeling. And a lot of jokes about venereal disease in the play are of this kind. Angelo enters, just run back, I'm not going to read much of it, so I'll give you some sense of the feeling of the play. It tells you it's going to be about matters which could become abstract, of government the properties to unfold, but government above all means law, means the exercise of justice, combined if you can manage it with mercy. So that's the government, that's the aspect of government that the play attends to. Aeschylus, if any in Vienna be of worth to undergo such ample grace and honour, it is Lord Angelo. Look where he comes. Always obedient to your grace's will, I come to know your pleasure. Angelo, there is a kind of character in thy life that to the observer doth thy history fully unfold. Of government, the property to unfold. One thing Shakespeare is doing is unfolding the word unfold for us. You can say you won't necessarily remember that, but your hearing is a much better guide to memory than perhaps any other of the senses. I know that certain beers reach parts of the body which other beers do not reach. Nevertheless, there's something about sounds and how they work for us. And of course, we need to remember that many of the members of Shakespeare's audience were illiterate, and the better memories they had as a result. Nobody in the room has any memory any longer because you write it down immediately into some tablet or palm pilot or whatever it is now called, or your screen here. So you don't have to remember anything any longer. You don't have to remember how to add things up. You don't have to remember what you've gone out to buy and so on. The illiterate audience had a very, very good memory, and it could remember across great distances, as we all can with music. People remain very, very good at picking up Mozart or Handel or Haydn will need only to have a tiny, tiny little run of notes for it to call something movements later and so on. Francis Yates, I may have mentioned in a previous lecture here, Francis Yates wrote about the theatre of memory and how the Elizabethan Jacobean world trained itself in memory through an imaginary theatre, rather as some people do with an imaginary street or an imaginary house. There's a building here to commemorate each of the presidents of the United States of America or each of the monarchs of England and so on. So memory is very, very alive. And things which would seem far-fetched, you think the critic only knows this because he or she has read the play many, many times. Otherwise you wouldn't notice it. I think things will register with you whether you are conscious or not. And if you have heard only 20 or 30 lines earlier, of government, the properties to unfold, as the first full line of a play, when the same speaker says that to the observer doth thy history fully unfold, something is happening which will chime with you whether you are conscious of it or not. That is, one of the things that art loves doing is registering on you whether you are conscious of it or not, and sometimes it wants to register all the more because you're not conscious of it. That is, there will be these subliminal things which will stay with you in a way that the conscious memory would not be able to manage or would not wish to manage. Thyself and thy belongings are not thine own so proper as to waste thyself upon thy virtues, they on thee. Heaven doth with us as we with torches do, not light them for themselves, for if our virtues did not go forth of us, 'twere all alike as if we had them not. Let me read that again. It's very knotty. You're in a play where there's a very, very knotty winding and insinuating all the time within the language. That idea of unfolding something, wanting to get it exactly right, knowing it has to be provisional and tentative, not nailed down. Thyself and thy belongings, that is your endowments, your talents. Thyself and thy belongings are not thine own so proper as to waste thyself upon thy virtues, they on thee. Heaven doth with us as we with torches do, not light them for themselves. For if our virtues did not go forth of us, 'twere all alike as if we had them not. Spirits are not finely touched, but to fine issues. Nor nature never lends the smallest scruple of her excellence, but like a thrifty goddess, she determines herself the glory of a creditor, both thanks and use. But, and then he cuts across himself like a lot of people in Shakespeare who have spoken very, very beautifully, but fear they are starting to weary the listener or the audience. He cuts across himself. But I do bend my speech to one that can my part in him advertise. That is, you could yourself speak better on this than I can, that's the thought. Hold, therefore, Angelo, in our remove, be thou full ourself. Mortality and mercy in Vienna live in thy tongue and heart. Old Aeschylus, though first in question, is thy secondary. Take thy commission. And that's the story that's set up at the very opening of the play. And you will have heard from the summary of the play how it is subsequently fulfilled. Now, everybody has pointed out, all the critics of the play pointed out, that there are three components to it. There's a triangle. There's a story of the corrupt magistrate, and that's the story of Angelo, who's corrupted and seeks to extort her virginity from Isabella, the reward for her being saving her brother's life. There's a story or legend of a disguised ruler, and you will have come across lots of works where somebody in disguise returns in order to see what is actually the case and to rectify it, perhaps. There's often a perhaps in that, the disguised ruler. And thirdly, there's the tale of the substituted bedmate, the woman who speaks to the man is not the woman he had supposed he was sleeping with. So that is, Mariana still loves Angelo, despite how he treated her. Mariana is willingly, as it were, sacrifices herself, and it is not a sacrifice. And at the end of the play, she gets to marry Angelo, though Angelo doesn't have any choice about the matter. And whether it's a good idea to have a marriage in which one of the partners does not have any choice is a real question. It's a real Shakespearean question, too. So those are the three things. I agree with the great Cambridge critic F.R. Leavis in saying that the focus is on the story of the corrupt magistrate. That is, it's essentially a play about Angelo and his relations to Isabella and to others. Leavis said, we know where we have to focus our critical attention and our moral sensibility. Not that is upon the Duke, but upon the representatives of human nature that provide the subjects of the demonstration. And it's an experiment. It's a terrible experiment, not quite as terrible as the experiment in the Book of Job, where God sets up an experiment, does he not? Indeed, with the devil, sets up an experiment. When the great Russian poet Pushkin turned to the story, he called it simply Angelo, and the whole of his poem is about the Angelo story. So how it happened is not a question. What is happening is the real is the real object of attention. Now, there's a group of Shakespeare's plays which in the old days used to be thought of as problem plays, or called problem plays, and the scholar who wrote most substantially about them, Ernest Shuns, has said this. I'm going to quote it and just disagree with it, which is how one makes a living in my life. A problem play is a play in which we find a concern with the moral problem, which is central to it, presented in such a manner that we're unsure of our moral bearing. So that uncertain and divided responses to it in the mind of the audience are possible and even probable. Now, I think that's true except for the bit that goes like this. A moral problem which is central to it, presented in such a manner that we are unsure of our moral bearings. Now, it's not the presentation that makes us unsure, it's the fact itself. These are things about which we ought to be unsure of our moral bearings. The time will come when you better stop being unsure and act upon it, but until that time, it is very valuable to be unsure, to have something like what Keats called negative capability. Negative capability, that is the ability to be in doubts, uncertains, mysteries, without any irritable reaching after fact and reason. Now, we need fact and reason an immense lot of the time, but we also need time for fact and reason are not up for us to settle them, not solutions and so on. So these are moral problems which are central, irrespective of how you present them. So I'm going to start with philosophy and law, something we must all care about. But for many of us, the most important branch of philosophy now is legal philosophy. That is, well, it's not simply that the Supreme Court matters immensely in the United States of America, it's that the philosophical arguments by lawyers come home and bite. They have bite. What is it to possess something? Is that a purely linguistic point? Is it a legal point? If you're asleep and I put a drug into an illegal drug in your pocket, are you in possession of it? The law needs to think out what it means by in possession. That is, can I be in possession of something I didn't know I was in possession of? And all of these questions need to be attended very patiently by philosophy. So take the matter of Angelo's intentions. When at the end of the play, very, very beautifully, Isabella kneels and pleads that Angelo not be executed. She has not been told that her brother has been saved from the executioner. In fact, the person who was supposed to be there instead of her brother has also been saved from the execution. It's rather wonderful. There's some person that they're very happy to chop the head off, and he says, "No, not today. I'm tired. I'm sorry. Wonderfully rendered minor character in Shakespeare play. So they don't chop his head off either. Fortunately, there's somebody dead. You know, there's often a dead person lying around whose head you can chop off and use if need be to get sent to the Duke. Anyway, Claudio's life is not taken, though his sister believes it has been, and this is why it is a great test for her. Everybody in the play is tested in some way. I want to say including the Duke, though that's a particular complication. So, pleading for the life of Angelo, Isabella says this, "Let him not die. My brother had but justice in that he did the thing for which he died. For Angelo, his act did not overtake his bad intent and must be buried but as an intent that perished by the way. Thoughts are no subjects, intents but merely thoughts." So it's come to thinking, if you did your best to kill somebody and you didn't succeed, you know what I mean, should you be punished? And what degree of punishment should attend upon you? Now, it seems to me a real philosophical question, and it's a real legal question. The law has rightly been preoccupied, for instance, with whether or not you can be punished for attempting something that's impossible. If I try to pick your pocket, as I put my hand, I pick your pocket, and there's nothing in your pocket, it's clear that I couldn't have picked your pocket. It's not only that I didn't, it's that I couldn't possibly have done so. So the law has a problem about things that are impossible. If I attempt to murder you by having a photograph of you and setting fire to it, that doesn't really count as attempted murder in most legal systems, though it would in some cultural conditions, because I couldn't possibly kill you by burning a photograph, do you mean? So it is a key question when your intents are not overtaken. You intended to do this. He intended to kill her brother. He didn't kill I mean, well, I got the wrong point of this stupidly. He intended to sleep with her. He did not sleep with her. His act did not overtake his bad intent. So I think every legal system has a problem with this, and we ought to be in two minds about it. We ought to find it very, very difficult, and we shouldn't know clearly what to do in advance of any singular instance of it. So, I just want to quote, for instance, from a great Victorian. I often go back to the Victorian thinkers to show that something has been around for a long time, though viewed differently then. It is greatly to be regretted, said James Fitzjames Stephen, who was a judge, it is greatly to be regretted that attempts to murder, which fail only by accident, should not be capital. They should be capital offences, you see. And there are one or two other crimes of which the same might be said. And it's true that if you try to get a clear, rational, common sense purchase of it, it becomes very, very difficult. So then here's another of the cases that he writes about in 1857. A policeman attempted to arrest this man on suspicion of a robbery, a suspicion probably well-founded. He resisted desperately, at last drew a pistol and fired it at the policeman. The bullet, was only prevented from killing him by the ornaments on his collar. He's punished. The punishment, though severe, seems to have been inadequate, for the prisoner did all he could to murder the policeman. You do all you can to murder somebody, and if you don't succeed in murdering them through mere happenstance and accident, I push you out of a window, you happen to land on a window cleaner, only a few feet down. So, whereas if you'd hit the pavement, my punishment would be quite different. So it is very hard to think through the rationale of these decisions, and yet pretty well everybody thinks there'd be something terribly wrong. It is in some deep moral way counterintuitive to think that it would be all right to treat attempted murder as though it had been murder, whatever the circumstances. Two realms together. Now, so it's part of my position about literature and people whom I met here a few months ago, remember, I want to say with T.S. Eliot that literature attends to things which are of enduring human concern and which would matter whether there were any writers or not. These things matter not because Shakespeare writes about them. Shakespeare writes about them because they matter. That's the way round. And again there will be moral problems of this kind. What literature will often say to you is, don't rush. Please be given pause. Nobody any longer says it's a good thing to... something should give you pause. That is, you shouldn't rush to a judgment or a vote on it. You should realise how exceptionally difficult, and there may not be a satisfactory solution that you can carry on and apply to the next case. You may have in every case to think this through. So these are problems of government, the government and the problems to unfold. And they go, of course, with huge philosophical arguments about consequentialism and intrinsicalism. Now, the people who have written about this, a friend of mine, James Griffin, has written about it, have become unhappy with the clear antithesis. But in working terms, you can say this is intrinsically wrong, or you can say this is wrong because it has very bad consequences. And there is some clash between those two things. There's the general problem of how do you work out what all the consequences would be. And when the philosopher G.E. Moore writes about it, he wants to come out, if he possibly can, for results the test of right and wrong. It was the right thing to do if it had good results. It was the wrong thing to do if it had bad results. And he argues this position with great force, but almost nobody, except a philosopher when writing a book, can live by that. You find you can't read. That is... the man beat you to a pulp, but actually he didn't. He dislodged a tumour which would have had you dead the next day, and you're now up and about. So the right and wrong result, the result's the test of right and wrong, means that whatever your motives were, and whatever the act you perpetrated, if it turned out to create some of it. So it's a terrible spin-off from utilitarianism, from the idea that the greatest happiness of the greatest number. The more good results you have for the more people, the better it was to do it or not to do it. I think pretty well everybody is an intrinsicalist in some respects and a consequentialist in others. If you simply say, if you become a thoroughgoing intrinsicalist, then with Kant, you have to argue that you must never lie. You must never lie. The murderer comes in, the torturer comes in and says, where is the baby? And you say, it's in the cupboard. And you have to say that because for Kant, the loss to society of ever condoning a lie is greater than the massacre and torture of any human being. on the supposed right to lie. It's a very, very powerful essay, and it shows you that you shouldn't ever have much to do personally with philosophers, except some of the ones in the room. some of the ones in the room. It's a very, very extraordinary thing, on the supposed right to lie. Pretty well every... Now, you can say this goes on the supposed right to torture or to not torture. This takes you on into films that are part fact and part fiction about the capture of Bin Laden and so on. So we're through into a whole world in which does the end justify the means? Nobody should ever, I think, simply say yes or no. The answer horribly is yes and no. We can imagine terrible circumstances in which, etc. But the extreme positions don't make sense, and most people muddle along in a thoroughly decent way with some combination of intrinsicalism and consequentialism. Angelo breaks his promise. Maybe he promises, and he promises that he won't. He breaks his promise because he then, in his having enjoyed her by night, he sends the message to execute her brother. So he's breaking a promise. Is he the better or the worse for breaking a promise? Promise breach is rightly a very big and central philosophical and also legal matter. You can call it a promise, you can call it a contract, and so on. The contract replaces what would have been giving your word. Your word is your bond, you don't need another kind of bond. These are real and continuing questions, and Shakespeare is profoundly interested in them, not in some schematic or abstract way, but as they live themselves out in particular people whom he has imagined with the help of previous writers. That is, he didn't imagine these people into existence. There are clear sources for this particular play. So let's think about the way in which the law is a kind of backlash in the law, repeatedly. The situation in the play is that there are laws for all faults, but faults so countenanced that the strong statues stand like the forfeits in a barber shop, as much in mock as mark. You're confronted with a repeated social question here, which is nobody takes any notice of the law. It says you may not ride bicycles on this bit of Boston Common, and everybody rides bicycles on. It says no right turn, and then everybody turns right, and so on. At what point do you think it would be salutary, not necessarily to torture, but to deprive of pleasures for a very long time, somebody who turns right on the right, that turns right when he's not supposed to? What you're getting at is what's the nature of the appeal that you will make to a very... It's like those particularly exemplary damages, those terrible damages that are sometimes visited on a corporation as a lesson to all the others. Do you see what I mean? That's all, that whole world. So promise breach and the law would be one aspect of this. I want to turn to the particular characters, though, and talk about the problems that come up with them. Isabella is almost always written about by the editors of this play and the commentators on the play as if she behaves very badly. One such critic has called her a mere vixen in her virtue. Misogyny plays its part in some of these things. What would surely have been evident to an earlier age is the fact that her stance is occasioned by no true principle. She won't sleep with Angelo to save her brother's life. Her stance is occasioned by no true principle. Now, I think calling it a stance is already not good. She has something more than a stance. She has a religious belief, which is a conviction. It's not my belief, because I'm not religious and I'm not Christian. But by the Christian terms by which she lives, she is a novice in a nunnery, her body and her life are not hers to deal with indignity. They're not hers. Whose life is it anyway? There's a very good piece in the Times recently a week or two ago by Freya Johnson about suicide, that all those arguments about whether your body and your life are your own. Mere vixen in her virtue. Her brother, very beautifully says, might there not be a charity in sin to save this brother's life? I mean, this is a question which Angelo puts and which her brother himself turns to and so on, but she won't. She won't fail it. Now, those who think her wrong, I think, need to think this out very, very carefully and very patiently. You need to distinguish the various grounds of it. Is it that Angelo is not really asking very much of her anyway? Now, that would be one view. That is that having sexual intercourse with somebody whom you don't like is extremely regrettable. It shouldn't be forced on you. It shouldn't be extorted from you. It's not blackmail. We tend to say these things are blackmail. Not blackmail. It's extortion. Blackmail is one form of extortion. When your mother practices or your father practices emotional blackmail, it's not really blackmail. They're not saying they're going to tell the world something about you. It's a kind of extortion. Isn't that right? You feel extorted. So there are moral and emotional extortions. Is it that Angelo doesn't really ask much? That, for a certain generation of certain people, that really would be the case. So the disproportion between what is asked of her, I don't know how any Christian could think that. I can't see how a Christian could or should think that. Are there any humiliations he could ask from her which, setting aside all the religious and superhuman or supernatural sanctions, are there any humiliations he could ask which it would be her duty to reject? You will save your brother's life if you do such and such. Do you get me? Now, I think pretty well everybody in the room would have some such thing. That is, there are things he could ask of her. Terrible that her brother's like her, but the deep human indignity of certain things. Now, the way we could, if this were a social occasion, we would talk amicably about what these things might be. Do you know what I mean? What might the humiliations be that somebody in the situation asked of you, which you couldn't, for all your, as it were, liberalism, actually accord with? Certain kinds of indignities towards your parents. Are certain things of you in relation to your parents? Are certain things of children? Do you see what I mean? Wouldn't you at that point think, I'm sorry, whether it saves somebody's life or not? For some people, the flag is such a thing. It probably isn't for me, except when we're at war. I mean, during the Second World War, the flag might have meant that for me. But clearly in America, the flag means certain things. And there are people who would not save an individual person's life at the expense of desecrating the flag. And that has to mean something to everybody, even if they wouldn't themselves have those priorities. So if you think she's in the wrong, you've got to be clear, you've got to walk around it as though it were a work of sculpture. It's characteristic of great works of art to aspire to a condition of sculpture, as if they might need to be viewed through 360 degrees, not simply on a page, not even simply on a stage, because you can't see the stage through 360 degrees. Walk all around it and think it through. I don't see how those who share her religion, as it's presented in the play. And then there's a whole other very worldly point. If she yields her body to Angelo, will he in fact save her brother's life? The answer, of course, is no. He believes she has yielded his body. Of course he won't. The wise man who extorts a woman, who extorts something for you, then does not act on the bribe. If somebody's given you a bribe and then accuses you of having taken a bribe, you say, I can be ridiculous. Obviously, I didn't take a bribe. I went ahead with exactly what I was supposed to do. She is very, very vulnerable in the matter of whether he will act on his promise. It's powerful in the play because she doesn't say to herself or to anybody else in the play, if I do this, it won't even save my brother's life. Do you feel me? Which I think is not a modern reflection and it wouldn't have been around there, but it would figure in any sensible film. If it were in Blue Velvet, as it were, think of a world of kind of macabre crimes and extortions, as there are in that film, it would figure there that the person would say, it's not going to work anyway. The reply to that might be, if it has the tiniest chance of working, you should do it. She doesn't herself put it, but the play vindicates. Her decision is vindicated by something that never even occurred to her. That is, her brother's life is not going to be saved by this. So all she would have done is outrage her deepest convictions and give pleasure to a monster, doubly sick pleasure to a monster, with no gain whatsoever. That's a different consideration, but it's one that has to be raised by the play. Then the third thing about her is the severity with which she distances herself from her own decision. And I find that very touching. I don't find that glacial, cold, frigid, unloving at all. At the end of the scene, she says to her brother, she can't believe that he pleased with her. At first he is dignified and manly, and then he weakens when he, at one of Shakespeare's very, very greatest speeches, either to die and go we know not where, to lie in cold instruction, and to rot. This sensible, warm notion to become a needy clod, and so on. The delighted spirit. That's a wonderful, wonderful speech. Imagining yourself dead with it, an eternity of a particular kind of torment to go through. So, at the end of the scene, she says to her brother, die perish. Might but my bending down reprieve thee from thy fate, it should proceed. I'll pray 1,000 prayers for thy death. No word to save thee. Now, I think it's very thrilling how much exaggeration and hyperbole she has to put into dealing with what she has decided to do. When people say this is completely heartless, it isn't. It's fully alive with heart. It has to go off into this very thrilling melodrama. You know, I'm going to pray for your death. And so, no, you're not. But you're trying to deal with the immediate terrifying consequences of the decision you've taken, probably rightly, but which you will, as they say, have to live with for the rest of your life. So this seems to be part of the Isabella story, and I contrast it with this from the New York Times a while ago, actually by a member of the family that owns the New York Times. I know there are voters who do believe that a president should have what they consider a spotless sexual history. Personally, the only candidate for public office I would automatically disqualify on sexual grounds would be a rapist or a virgin. That's probably the nastiest thing ever to appear in the New York Times, and that's saying something. Like most newspapers, they repeatedly write things that are absolutely vile. A rapist or a virgin? It's a joke. Is it funny? Has it any intelligence to it at all? It's what you can say if you own a newspaper. Now, Isabella defies a huge temptation, which is, of course, not to tell her brother. Not to tell her brother that Angelo has said. It's a great tribute to her that she knows that she has to. It never even enters her head that she might not tell her brother. When she comes back for the second interview, he is in hope that he will live. She moves immediately to the high religious ground. The news is good news because things are better in heaven than they are on this earth. So that's essentially the move she makes, and it's entirely honourable, though perfectly honourably doesn't convince him. Is there no remedy? He says. And she, the wonderful line, absolute great opportunity for an actor, clearly. Is there no remedy? None. But, none but. So it depends how much of space you let in between none and but. There's a moment when none represents a possibility for it. Is there no remedy? None. And then she needn't go through this terror, self-harrowing and harrowing end. She needn't go through it. But she is honest, and her principles require that she say none but such remedy as to save a head to cleave a heart in twain. But is there any? He comes back, but is there any? Yes, brother, you may live. And so on. So there's something about her candor here, which I think is very thrilling. Her principles are not mine, and she's in many ways dislikable, like Jane Eyre, like a lot of very admirable people in books and in life. She's perfectly admirable, and in some respects, very dislikable. But this is, I think, is there no remedy? None. And her saying none opens up this possibility for to do what many, many people would. You haven't got to tell your brother you're not going to do this and so on. It's a temptation so unresisted as never even have to be mentioned. And I think that is greatly to her credit. One of the big puzzles in the play is why it is greatly to greatly to his discredit that he behaves as he does. He's a character who makes witty, flippant remarks all the way through the play. And he talks to the Duke when the Duke is in disguise about the Duke and how he's the Duke of Dark Corners and so on. And he's frivolous, and he is treated in some ways more severely than anybody in the play. And that is, there's a whole world of moral and spiritual judgments in that too. Are the really terrible people not the people who do monstrously evil things on the Angelo scale, but the people who just always have some witty banter, some ironical remark, some little sneer, some simper, some cutting of everything down into cynicism? He's the wittiest person in the play. He's the person whose company you might most like. He's not a villain like Iago, who's the wittiest person in Othello. Iago's the best company in the play. If you said, could I like spending the evening with Iago or Othello? Of course you'd spend the evening with Iago. You'd hear these wonderfully witty, malicious things about your friend. That would be the good bit, and so on. So there's Richard III. I mean, Richard is so unremittingly witty in the play. You wish he were a good person, except good people tend not to be like that. So there's some terrible thing that you're caught in, and so on. Triviality is a greater danger to the soul than wickedness. That very English thought of a certain kind, was when it was proposed that we might have commercial television instead of the BBC. Pilkington report, triviality is a greater danger to the soul of the media. And there's something in it. You see, the terrible thing is there's actually something in it. A life opener. If all you ever got was a certain kind of sitcom, if all you ever got was the terrible indignity and shallowness, that is, Angelo is deep. He does deep, dark, very, very bad things, but he's deep. Lucio is thought actually to be just somebody who makes kind of clever remarks and so on, and is therefore more corrosive. Have you seen a film called The Cane Mutiny from a very, very long time ago? It has Humphrey Bogart, so that might get people to see it. It turns out that the villain in the film is the man who is always cynically witty all the way through. That is, the captain himself is a really troubled, tragic soul, and Bogart can convey that very powerfully. But it's the person all along from the side makes a certain kind of remark. Do you come in? Cutting things down to size. So there are problems in judgment about Lucio, but I can make sense of them, I think. And then they'll go back to the problems about Angelo. Is he better or worse as the play proceeds? Does he get better or does he get worse? You see, by the end of the play, he acknowledges things about himself, which I think mean he's in a better spiritual condition than at the beginning of the play. At the beginning of the play, he scarce confesses his blood flows. He believes himself to be superior. There's a problem with the plot of the play. I'll come back to that in a few minutes, and then we'll stop and I'll take questions. But it's very remarkable that there's a depth of understanding in him of what he is and what he has done by the end of the play that is not there earlier. What dost thou, or what art thou, Angelo? He asks himself, and as the play goes on, there are better and better answers to that. Blood, thou art blood. It feels like it's tautology. Blood, thou art blood. He looks at what he has done, and he has given lives of great beauty and dignity. He simply wishes to be dead. When he is revealed as having done this, he simply goes, "Oh, my dread lord, I should be guiltier than my guiltiness to think I can be undiscernible when I perceive your grace like power divine has looked upon my passes. Then, good prince, no longer session hold upon my shame, but let my trial be mine own confession. Immediate sentence then and sequent death is all the grace I pray." Picks up the word grace, which is honour to you, when I perceive your grace, like I am, and he comes back to, it's all the grace I lay. And there is a kind of, he just wishes to be dead. I mean, he is so ashamed, so understanding. So it's very, very strange. But it's as if we're all, often we are all, on two escalators, one's going up and the other's going down. You might be getting morally worse and spiritually better. In the spiritual value, would say that he is open to understanding things at the end of the play that he couldn't understand at the beginning. And one of the things you might want is that people be open. The complete psychopath is not open to anything. It's so encased in something. Angelo, at the end of the play, isn't getting the worst. And something the same is true of Macbeth. It's a real question whether Macbeth is worse as a person at the end of the play than he was at the beginning. He knows things at the end he didn't know before. He may be destined to eternal torment, and it suits some of the characters in the play to say that he is, but we wouldn't have to agree with them. So that seems to be part of what the problem in judgment is. Excuse me. Now, these things are very, very elusive. They're very elusive in life. You will see this in the people around you. You will see that they're getting better in some ways and worse in some ways in doing the very, very same things that they're doing. Judging characters, whether in life or in literature, is never easy. People have had recourse to the word judgmental, which is the most judgmental word there is. People always say, "Why are you so judgmental?" That's the word that really passes a judgment on you. That's the word, "Why are you so judgmental about my being judgmental?" And then you can explain that after you've met 10 years and so on. But it's very, very powerful when the world started to say judgmental, as though passing a judgment were a bad thing to do. Censorious meant a bad way of passing an adverse judgment because you took pleasure in it. That's what censorious was. It conveyed that in finding this to be disapproved of, you're approving of yourself and so on. Very, very difficult to escape that. But the terms moral and spiritual seem to me to have to come into it. His last words in the play, that I crave death more willingly than mercy, 'tis my deserving, and I do entreat it. They're very, very moving lines, and what they remind you is that mercy is often not mercy. The Duke says mercy is not, often isn't mercy when it seems to be mercy, because somebody goes on and commits another offence. Isn't that right? You see this all the time in decisions. There's somebody in the Department of English who is okay, but not very good, but it would be a you know him, you know he's got wife and children, he's perfectly decent, he's just that he's second rate, and so on. Do you or don't you give him tenure in the American system? And the thing is always skewed by the fact that you know that person and you don't know the other people. You have no image of who it is who would be here in the event of there being now a vacancy. Right? And Angelo, who is a powerfully unjust person, who is often very wise, when he's urged to show mercy, he says, I show it most of all when I show justice. For then I pity those I do not know. Every time you pity somebody who is a drunken driver, you are failing to pity those you do not know, the people who, as a result of this leniency of sentence, do you know what I mean, will not think twice about driving when drunk. So these are part of, and it's part of that Shakespeare's ability to give bad people very wise things to say. Many of the wisest things in Hamlet are said by the king. It would be good if they were said by somebody who hadn't behaved as badly as yet, but that's perfectly compatible with his saying deep, true, wise thing. So Coleridge became very indignant with the play. He said the play baffles the strong, indignant claim of justice. He ought to have been worried about indignant there, that his indignation is such a plague, isn't it? Everybody likes being indignant. Baffles the strong, indignant claim of justice, and indignant actually doesn't fit very well with justice. Justice doesn't want to be indignant. It brings in its own injustices if you're not careful. Not merely baffles the strong indignant claim of justice, for cruelty with lust and damnable baseness cannot be forgiven. I think human beings shouldn't quite say that. Now I'm just going to end. I haven't been looking at my watch, and now I look at my watch. We started a little bit late. The big thing hanging over all this, though, is doesn't it make nonsense of any serious attention to these philosophical matters? The philosophical matters that have to do with Angelo's act, not his act in wishing to sleep with or to execute Claudio, and both occasions being defeated. It was only an intent. It didn't ever happen. So huge questions about what a crime is. If when we really simplify the law, we say a crime, there has to be an act, and there has to be mens rea, a guilty mind. Having said that, we immediately say, but there are lots of cases where that doesn't apply. Conspiracy, you have to find what is the act in a conspiracy. Societies need laws against conspiracies. Was buying a box of matches an act sufficient to find me guilty of arson? Conspiracy to commit arson. How many of those things would you have to have before you could have the conspiracy? And they're particularly, because of course the act never happened. A crime is an act, but the forethought forestalled the act. So there's that whole question, as well as the larger questions of what it is to fail to do something evil which you meant to do. The problem is tragicomedy, because tragicomedy seems to be letting us off. This is clearly a play which has amazing improbabilities in it. And if you believed that they were meant to seem probable, this would be a very bad play. And there are many people for whom it is a bad play, including many of the people who've edited it, who say in the end, the effect of all the improbabilities is to mean that you can't take the work seriously. How could you think seriously about whether somebody gets better or worse, whether Angelo gets better or worse in the play, given all the improbabilities? Well, it depends how you're to take in probabilities. In a surrealist painting, you are to know that these are not just improbabilities, they are impossibilities. And you're to compare the painting with what you know the transactions of the world to be. And I think Shakespeare repeatedly works in the same way. That is, you're not supposed to think, there's no need to worry about trying to do things terribly evil, various things, because probably a dupe-like figure will intervene and protect us against the consequence of our actions. It's something like what you do when you show something in slow motion, or whether you, for instance, run a reel back. What happens when you run a reel back? If the person in the film doesn't hit the pavement because you run it and it goes back the other way, do you feel more terror of gravity or less terror of gravity? I think you feel more. The effect of strobe lighting is not, in fact, to freeze people, but to make you aware of how extraordinarily they move all the time. If you do that really violent thing with strobe lighting, you give the illusion, which is known to be an illusion, how extraordinary that this person who's moving looks as if he or she is caught totally unmoving. And that perhaps it's gone out. And I was saying, perhaps it hasn't gone out. It's frightening, like a lot of technological things which move into your inmost being. Everybody is betrayed by his or her response to strobe lighting because of what motion and movement and excitement are. It freezes everything. And nothing more powerfully conveys you that things won't freeze. They don't freeze. So how are the improbabilities in the plot meant to be taken? I think they're meant to be taken like the improbability in the Winter's Tale. You can wrong your wife, and perhaps she can be stashed away for a very, very long time and return and love you again. But I wouldn't count on it if I were you. The Shakespeare play, I think, is saying, just imagine what would need to happen for you to be protected against these bad things which every day we do. Every kind of injustice we do. Just imagine what would have to happen for there to be no terrible consequences. This play proceeds in some ways just as life does. In some ways it's worse than life. In some ways it's better than life. You have to ask yourself whether you really like happy endings. Do happy endings actually make you happy? Half of the point of the happy endings is to make you unhappy. Because in the very moment when you know this is very unlikely to happen, you're reminded of the conditions under which you live. Most people leave happy films and plays with a rather somber tread. We've just seen people actually getting the happy things that they deserve and being very good with it. I hate it. Now you look at your own life. That's right. It is so. Let it be so with a generous heart. We don't find it easy to be generous about other people's happiness. People leave tragedies bounding out. They're bound up. They think things like, well, I never had my father's eyes gouged out. I made that of myself. Or I never sent him out onto the blasted heat. There's absolutely nothing to wear and nothing to eat. So we tear ourselves up. If it's worse than life, in a funny way, it's the relation of happiness to unhappiness is very tricky and easy. But there's one major thing which I just have to mention, which is for me a real flaw in the play, and that is that Angelo has an evil past. Now, I want to believe it when it is said, if any in Vienna be of worth to undergo such ample grace and honour, it is not Angelo. I want to believe that because I think it's the self-righteousness of people like that that is immensely morally and spiritually dangerous. It then turns out that he jilted Mariana because she wasn't going to bring in the dowry the money he thought she would bring. He therefore cancelled, he was engaged to marry, he was pre-contracted to marry her, he cancelled his pre-contract marriage with Mariana because we are told there's no dowry, and he professed professed discoveries in her dishonour. That is, he said that she had been unfaithful to him and bruited that around. Now, that's compatible with lots of people, but it's very damaging to the play. Because it turns out, in my opinion, I long to read somebody who can persuade me that actually it isn't damaging to the play, because I think the play is very, very thrillingly good. But what happens is that it turns out that he was never somebody to trust anyway. So all the play shows you is that somebody who was never to be trusted can't be trusted. Yeah. That's not nearly as interesting as somebody who looks as if he could be trusted, who has immense misplaced confidence in himself and so on. I'll just end with this exchange. I meant to give you more time to questions, but we have a bit of time, I hope. This is for me the most moving and beautiful Christian moment in any of Shakespeare's plays, and I care immensely about it because I'm not a Christian and I like being very moved by things which remind me of how imaginatively generous great Christian speaking and writing can be. He says very coldly to her when she asks, may she please for her brother's life, he says, your brother is a forfeit of the law, and you but waste your words. And she says very beautifully, alas, alas. And it's very beautiful, alas, because it's partly sadness at what may happen, and partly sadness at his not comprehending the very thing that he is saying. So she says, alas, alas, when you're going to put something to somebody which will make them see the truth. Your brother is a forfeit of the law, and you but waste your words. Alas, alas, why all the souls that were forfeit once, and he that might the vantage best have took, found out the remedy. How should you be if he which is the top of judgment should but judge you as you are? Or think on that, and mercy then will breathe your lips like man. It's absolutely wonderful. It's a great moment. I think there's nothing even in the Christian poems of George Herbert that is as moving as that, why all the souls of the world were forfeit once. He'd handed her this word. It's rather wonderful. A great dramatist, of course, is somebody who knows that people hand other people words. And your words are then prompted by the thing you've heard, not the situation you've been in, and not some abstract concept or sentiment you wrote the very words. All the souls of the world were forfeit once. And he doesn't even have to say the name of our Lord. And he that might advantage best to found out the remedy. It's very, very beautiful, I think. Questions, please. Read the play. See the play if you can. It's not a play that's often performed. And you'll be astonished at the moment when you wait. You know that Isabella would kneel, especially if you read the book, but it's an extraordinary moment on stage. Against all sense, you do importune her. Against all sense, everything in her physical senses, it doesn't make any philosophical or common sense. Against all sense, you go, and then she kneels. It's very thrilling. Thank you for your company.